Dr. Erez Manela is a professor of history at Harvard University, where he teaches international history and the history of the United States and the world. He also serves as director of graduate programs at Harvard's Weatherhead Center for International Affairs and as co-chair of the Harvard International and Global History Seminar. He is co-editor of the Global and International History series for Cambridge University Press, the volume Empires at War, 1911 to 1923, with Robert Gerwath, which reframes the history of the Great War as a global war of empires, and the Wilsonian moment, self-determination and the international origins of anti-colonial nationalism. Dr. Manela will close our symposium with a lecture that explores how President Wilson's ideas and convictions were formed, how they helped shape the 1919 peace settlement, and how that continues to impact us today. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Dr. Erez Manela.
Thank you, Laura, for that kind introduction. I just want to take a minute, since I'm the last speaker, to thank Laura and Matt and Camille and everybody else, all the rest of the staff at the World War I Museum and Memorial, including everybody who's kept us organized and on time and well-fed throughout these 2 days. This is the second time, as you mentioned, Laura, that I've worked with this group, I've been amazed by your intellectual engagement and by your organizational wizardry. So I'd like to take a moment to put our hands together and thank the people who brought us all here. In December of 1918, U.S. President Woodrow Wilson arrived in Britain en route to the peace conference then gathering in Paris, about which we've heard quite a bit already. Now, during his time in London, before he arrived in Paris, Wilson had a private interview with the deputy chief censor of Great Britain, a man by the name of Frank Worthington. In response to a question from Worthington about closer relations between Great Britain and the United States, Wilson, according to Worthington's notes, told him the following, and I quote, "You must not speak of us who come over here as cousins, still less as brothers. We are neither. Neither must you think of us as Anglo-Saxons, for that term can no longer be rightly applied to the people of the United States." He then concluded, and I quote again, "No, there are only two things which can establish and maintain closer relations between your country and mine. They are community of ideals and of interests." Now, this might seem like a surprising outlook to take for a man like Wilson, all the more so since it ran against common perceptions among US elites in that era. And let me just give you one example of an opposite perspective on this relationship. Some years earlier, the Scottish-American steel baron Andrew Carnegie published an essay in which he advocated at length for the reunification of Britain and North America. In that essay, Carnegie wondered why a mere disagreement over taxation, one that was already more than a century old, should result in a permanent separation. Now, in that essay, Carnegie then proceeded to offer six arguments from his proposed reunion, as he called it, of Britain and America. The first argument, and clearly in Carnegie's view the most important one, was about race. And I quote here from Carnegie. "First, in race, and there is a great deal in race, the American remains three-fourths purely British." He added that there is some mixture of German, but that too is Teutonic. I continue to quote, "The American remains British, differing less from the Briton than the Irishman, Scotsman, Welshman, and Englishman differ from each other." Continue to quote from Carnegie, it is to be noted that only in the region of political ideas is there dissimilarity, for no rupture whatever between the parts has ever taken place in language, literature, religion, or law. This is the end from Carnegie. Now, if we compare these two viewpoints, Carnegie on the one hand and Wilson on the other, the difference is striking. For Carnegie, Americans and Brits were one race separated by divergent political ideals. For Wilson, on the other hand, there were different races, quote-unquote races, united, if they were to be united, only by common ideals and interests. The divergence between Carnegie's view and Wilson's is even more striking if we consider that Wilson, like Carnegie, had deep roots in the British Isles, and even more specifically in Scotland. His paternal grandfather, James Wilson, was a Scotch-Irish immigrant from America to America from Northern Ireland. His maternal grandfather, Thomas Woodrow, after whom he was named, was born in Scotland and then moved just across the line to Northern England, to Carlisle, where he headed a congregation and where Woodrow Wilson's mother, Jessie, was born before emigrating to America. So what do we make of Wilson's statement in 1918? In order to understand it, I want to argue to you today, and more broadly, in order to understand his thinking on the post-war world in general, we need to take into account not only Wilson as the descendant of Scottish immigrants, not even, as many historians have often done, as the son of a minister and as a devout Presbyterian himself. After all, every single U.S. president in history has professed to be a believing Christian. So in this sense, Wilson is not unique. Now, of course, we can stipulate that some have done so more credibly than others, but nevertheless, they all have done it. Instead, we must cast our minds to the aspect in which Wilson was truly unique among U.S. presidents. That is to recall that he was the only president in the history of the United States, either before or after, who had earned a PhD degree, which is perhaps why he's a favorite of many academics, and made a distinguished career in academia, in the fields of history and politics, no less. And so what I want to argue to you today is that it's Wilson as the academic that we need to think about when we try to reconstruct the intellectual capital that he brought to his career as a first as a domestic political leader and then on the world stage. Let's begin with a bit of biography. Wilson, we know, was a product of the U.S. South, born in Virginia and raised in Georgia and South Carolina before and during the Civil War. He went on to attend the College of New Jersey, later renamed Princeton University, and studied law at the University of Virginia before attempting to practice it in the New South metropolis of Atlanta. But he quit law, bored out of his wits, within the year, and decided to pursue advanced studies in history and politics at the newly established Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore, Maryland. Hopkins had been founded only a few years before with the goal of importing the German university model of combining teaching with high-level research to the United States. This was a novel model at the time for American colleges. Thus, Wilson was a member of one of the very first cohorts of Americans to graduate in the United States with a PhD, which he received in 1886 at the age of 30. By 1890, he landed back at his alma mater, Princeton, and had launched a successful career as an academic and public intellectual. He published a steady stream of books and essays on American politics and history and became a popular teacher and lecturer. In 1902, he was appointed president of Princeton, and the decade of his presidency of Princeton that followed is still seen as a time when that university was transformed from something of a finishing school for Southern gentlemen into a serious research university. Now, I recount these biographical details because I think they are important to the task I've taken on in this lecture. And the task, as I said, is to make the argument that in order to better understand Wilson's thinking about the war and the peace that should follow it, in essence, to understand the sort of international order that Wilson was trying to put together in Paris, we must understand the origins of his thinking on the sources of order and disorder, sources of order and disorder in social and political life in general. One way to think about it is that Wilson's project was, and this is the alternate title of my presentation, to avert anarchy, to avert anarchy. And I use anarchy here in two senses of the word. The first sense, perhaps the most obvious one, is the anarchy of war, in this case, World War I. The second sense, related but separate, is the anarchy of social disorder, and specifically that one that the one that Wilson would have associated with so-called anarchists in his time, a designation in which he would most likely have lumped socialists. These two types of anarchy were, in Wilson's view, tightly connected in the modern world, and the remedy for them was tightly connected as well. That is to say, the two types of anarchy, social disorder on the one hand, war on the other. To see just how the two senses of anarchy that I've just defined were connected in his mind, we need to take stock of the intellectual capital that Wilson brought to his position as President of the United States, capital that he had accumulated over the roughly three decades of his adult life prior to his entry into politics around 1910. Now, I use the term intellectual capital here. Henry Kissinger is supposed to have said that decision makers, political leaders, don't have time in office to actually learn anything new, and so all of their decisions and outlooks when they are in office draw, he said, on the intellectual capital that they had accumulated prior to taking that position. So that's this intellectual capital that Wilson brought to his position is what I'm trying to trace for you today. It was during these decades, two and a half decades, from the start of his graduate studies, or actually close to three decades, from the start of his graduate studies to his appointment to academic administration, decades roughly from 1880 to 1900, that spanned some of the most tumultuous and transformative times in U.S. history. It was during that time that Wilson accumulated the intellectual capital that he would later draw on when he entered politics, first as the reformist governor of New Jersey from 1911 to 1913, and then as president of the United States. Wilson's thinking about politics, government, and the sources of social disorder and order, I argue to you, developed in the context of the domestic social and political life of the United States in the decades that preceded the war. Only later, after the war broke out, was the scheme that he developed applied to the international arena. So what is the intellectual framework within which Wilson interpreted the transformation that he saw around him, transformations that he saw around him unfolding from 1880 on? Wilson developed his political thought primarily during an era that we historians like to call the Gilded Age in the United States, which was, of course, as I'm sure all of you know, a time of profound historical transformation in U.S. history. And since I know all of you recall this from high school or perhaps later, I'll go over this material quite quickly. What are these transformations? Well, first perhaps, and this helps to explain Wilson's comment about Americans no longer being properly called Anglo-Saxons, this was an era of large-scale immigration into the United States, bringing new diversity and new tensions. From 1880 to 1910, some 20 million people arrived in the U.S., mostly from South and Eastern Europe. In the 1910 census, almost 15% of the population were counted as foreign-born, higher than even today. So, number one, immigration. Number two, sweeping technological changes during that era. In the fields of communication, the telegraph, I like to tell my students who think that the internet and social media have transformed and revolutionized our life, that revolution pales, I think, as against the revolution of the telegraph, because what happened then is that information that until that time could only travel at the speed of an individual human being, whether mounted on walking or running or mounted on a horse or on a ship, started to travel after that at the speed of light. And that really is a revolution. I think that goes far, much further in many ways than the one we've seen with the internet. So a revolution in communication, revolution in transportation, with the steam engine for ships and rail, and then the internal combustion engine for automobiles. Wilson, of course, was born and raised in the age of the horse and carriage, and by the time he was president, he had a presidential automobile. And I think not long after that, they started building the mall next to which I'm staying in Kansas City, the Country Club Plaza, which I was told was the very first mall built in the United States to accommodate customers coming by automobile. And the third and related set of technological changes, of course, had to do with the Industrial Revolution, again, based on steam engines and so forth. We see then in this era, Wilson saw in that era, rapid industrialization that by 1900 made the US economy account for some 25% of all global industrial production. We see also, relatedly, massive social dislocations, not just because of immigration, but also because of internal migration, the runaway growth of cities. Relatedly, we see recurring financial panics, as they were called at the time, in the 1870s and then in the 1890s, and Wilson was living throughout this whole time as an adult. And among all of this, and as a result, partially, of all of this, we see a steep rise in inequality, with the attendant strains on the social fabric. Now, if I had to summarize how Wilson himself saw the sum total of all of these changes in terms of their impact on society and politics, is that in his view, the result of all these changes was the rapid growth of unaccountable power concentrated in the hands of the few. Let me repeat that. The rapid growth of unaccountable power concentrated in the hands of the few. This, for him, was a moral problem, yes, but it was also, and more so, a problem of practical politics. Since, as he saw it, the unaccountable concentration of wealth and power as a historical phenomenon had to generate an inevitable counter-reaction, namely social unrest and indeed revolution. You could say that if he were a Marxist, he would have called it a dialectic. Now, this was no theoretical reflection. Those decades through which he lived and accumulated his intellectual capital were, in fact, rife with labor unrest, with social conflict, with the rise of ideologies and movements that Wilson saw as inimical to social and political order, not least the ideology that led to the assassination of President William McKinley in September 1901. Actually, this assassination was quite literally the historical event that brought progressivism to power, because it brought McKinley's vice president, Theodore Roosevelt, to the presidency. And the way I like to show this, I hope this is going to work, let's see, yeah. The way I like to show this when I teach about this in the classroom is to present these two threats to order, threats to democracy that Wilson saw. I'm sure you recognize J.P. Morgan on the right representing the concentration of unaccountable power in the hand of the few, in the hands of the few. And anybody recognize the individual on the left? Yes, Leon Czolgosz, the assassin of President McKinley, representing, in Wilson's view, the inevitable reaction to the phenomenon that Morgan represents. And Wilson, as he saw himself as a progressive political leader, his job was, if you will, to get in between those two and to hold the center, to make sure that through reform, the problem of unaccountable power in the hands of the few can be ameliorated so that it doesn't lead to anarchy and revolution. So, the solution in political terms for Wilson, which he articulated as a public intellectual and later implemented as a political leader, as a domestic political leader, was to push for a stronger role for government in the economy, particularly for the executive branch in the economy, in order to break up the trusts and regulate production, labor, and finance with the goal of restoring political balance and order. These reforms included the 8-hour workday, limits on child labor, and, of course, the founding of the Federal Reserve. And I just was driving by yesterday, the Federal Reserve Bank of Kansas City, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with. Now, Even before the outbreak of the Great War, Wilson could see this dialectic between concentrated unaccountable power and revolution play out not only domestically, but also abroad. In fact, the very first foreign policy crisis that Wilson faced when he came into office as president, this is even before the outbreak of World War I, was how to respond to the ongoing revolution then in Mexico. That revolution had broken out in 1910 with the removal of one strongman, and it seemed in early 1913, as Wilson just came into office, that it was on the cusp of inaugurating another military strongman into power. Wilson responded to this, rather to the surprise of his British interlocutors, by trying to support the liberals in Mexico by instituting an arms embargo against the militarists, which quickly led to conflict that saw U.S. Marines land in the Mexican Atlantic port of Veracruz. Ironically here, while U.S. actions did actually help the liberals in Mexico and ended up with the removal of that strongman who was in power at the time when Wilson came into power, they also turned the liberals at the same time against the U.S. since, as it turned out, no faction in Mexico wished to be associated with a Yankee military intervention on Mexican soil. So already the tensions in the Wilsonian operating procedure abroad is obvious in the Mexican case. In China too, which had its own Republican Revolution in 1911, Wilson saw the same dynamic at play, with the late dynasty representing unaccountable power and the revolution representing the inevitable reaction against it. As in Mexico, Wilson's policy toward China vacillated between letting events take their course and trying to tip the scales in the direction he favored with decidedly mixed results. Now, once the Great War broke out, Wilson spied yet again a similar dialectic at work there. That is to say, the connection between concentrated unaccountable power on the one hand and disorder and revolution on the other. On the world stage, it was the Kaiser, and to some extent also the Russian Tsar, who for Wilson represented the most visible symbols of unaccountable power. He called it autocracy. Exactly the sort of unaccountable power that would and could incite revolution. One reason that Wilson kept the U.S. out of war for the first nearly 3 years is that he believed that the Tsar, who was one of the Allies, was on the wrong side of history. This is also why when the March 1917 revolution in Russia replaced the Tsar with a provisional government that seemed to fit in a reformist mold, Wilson recognized the new government within a week, the first major nation to do so. This change in the Russian government, and this is after the removal of the Tsar from power, but before the Bolshevik takeover of the revolution later that year, this change also played a role in Wilson's decision to take the U.S. into the war the following month. So March is the revolution when the Tsar is removed. April is when the United States goes into war. With the Tsar gone, the Allies became less tainted in his eyes by the stain of autocracy. Now you may ask, what about the British and French, and for that matter, American overseas empires at that time? Surely those were also prime examples of unaccountable power exercise on the world stage. We'll get to that a bit later. In any case, the Bolshevik takeover of the revolution in Russia in November 1917 both changed the calculus and also proved to Wilson that he was in fact right. Wilson knew little of Lenin at that time, but he knew enough not to have any sympathy at all for his program. Lenin, in fact, epitomized precisely the sort of revolution that was bound to come of the persistence, as occurred in Russia under the Romanovs, of concentrated unaccountable power. Now, it's worth noting, I think, that Wilson and Lenin agreed on some things. That is, they both shared the sense that the established order, both domestic and international, had to be transformed in order to make power more accountable. But beyond that, they parted ways. What Wilson was looking for is a third way between reaction on the one hand, and revolution on the other. For Lenin, the choice was stark. Either you have reaction, defined by capitalism and imperialism, or you have revolution. There was, for Lenin, no third way. And this is the slide I use to represent Wilson's conundrum abroad. The Kaiser, on the one hand, representing unaccountable power. Lenin, on the other hand, representing the inevitable revolutionary response to unaccountable power. And Wilson coming into the war and then coming to Paris to try to hold the fort against both of these threats. Okay, so what were the main components of this Wilsonian third way in the context of the Paris Peace Conference? Put simply, they were the League of Nations and the principle of self-determination. Let's take each of them in order. I know you've heard quite a bit about each of them, but let's take each of them in order and examine them in the context of this framework that I've set up for you. First, the League. The crucial point here is that in Wilson's original conception of the League, it was not simply to be a body that would coordinate among individual, fully sovereign nation states, which is what it became later. Rather, in his original conception, it was to be an instrument in which states would pool some aspects of their respective sovereignties. In some ways, not unlike the European Union in recent decades. Maybe I should say the European Union before Brexit, or we'll see how that goes. But in any case, a supranational political structure in which nations or states would pool some of their sovereignty. It was to be, in Wilson's view, the League, also unrelatedly, an organization that would make the power of sovereign states and states' people more accountable to what Wilson liked to call world opinion. So hence helping to solve the problem of, or at least ameliorate the problem of unaccountable power in the hands of the few. There is plenty of evidence from the draft of the League Covenant that Wilson himself drew up immediately after the armistice and took with him to Europe, to the public statements that he made to the American public when he came back from Europe, that shows that this was the League that he wanted. That, by the way, was precisely Henry Cabot's Lodge main problem with the League that Wilson wanted. But doesn't that idea of pooling sovereignties in an international organization stand in conflict with the notion of self-determination, with which Wilson is also famously associated, and which seems to suggest, at least, the sanctity of national sovereignty? How can national sovereignty both be sacred and also be pooled in this international institution? Well, I would actually say quite the contrary. Such pooling of sovereignties as Wilson wanted in the League could, he thought, only work if it was done in a way that was accountable to the peoples involved, that is to say, in a way that took into account self-determination. Now, for Wilson, self-determination was never about, primarily about creating ethnically homogeneous polities. And by the way, Wilson borrowed the term self-determination from Bolshevik rhetoric. Very consciously he did so in order to try to defang, among other things, to try to defang the Bolshevik threat, as it were, by partially co-opting it. The term that he used himself prior to the Bolshevik Revolution was consent of the governed. That was his term of art, goes back, obviously, to several centuries in Anglo-American political thought, consent of the governed. Even when he started using the term self-determination, even when he became identified with it very closely, I've never been able to find a single instance in the archives, in the documents, where Wilson specifically defined self-determination as national self-determination. That's a phrase, as far as I can tell, that he never used. Lenin and Trotsky and other Bolsheviks, on the other hand, always talked about national self-determination. They're very specific about what sort of self-determination was to be had. And the reason was that Wilson knew very well, he was working from the American model, and he knew very well, as we could see from his statement to the British censor, that the United States was not an ethnically homogeneous nation, and that if it were to have self-determination, to the extent that it has self-determination, it was to be exercised through the consent of the government, through democratic and deliberative processes, and not through a process of ethnic homogeneity. And so the form in which the form that national self-determination took in Europe and to some extent also in parts of Asia after the war, that is to say ethnic cleansing and homogenization, that was not a Wilsonian idea. Those were ideas that were indigenous to Europe and to these other regions. So, as I was saying, for Wilson, it wasn't about creating ethnically homogenous polities, rather it was about establishing more accountable governments, thus ameliorating what he saw as the root cause of both war and revolution, both home and abroad. Again, the concentration of unaccountable power. Now, this, of course, was the theory, but Wilson was first and foremost, despite having a PhD, not a theorist, but a practical politician, which means he made many compromises, driven both by his own inconsistencies and prejudices, and we've heard about some of them earlier today, and also by the designs and interests of others who had power over the course of events. And we also heard quite a bit about those, not least from Margaret Macmillan last night. Now, there are many examples we can think of such Wilsonian compromises, but perhaps the most illustrative is the so-called League of Nations mandate system, which was the mechanism built into the League that was intended to reform imperial rule beyond Europe. Now, the mandate system was a compromise with the influence of the other allies, primarily the British and the French, who had no intention of letting go of their imperial possessions in the name of accountable government or self-determination, quite the opposite. It was also a compromise, the mandate system was, with Wilson's own prejudice, reflected in his sense that the peoples of Asia, of Africa, of the Middle East, were somehow less advanced in their, as he called it, political development than peoples in northern European descent, and therefore had to be prepared or tutored for self-government. And the mandates were to provide that preparation. Still, even with this compromised state, the League of Nations mandate system challenged, at least in principle, the absolute sovereignty of colonial powers over their colonies by making them explicitly accountable to an international authority. The mandate system did not topple colonialism immediately. It did not intend to. That would have been a revolution, and Wilson, as we know, was certainly not a revolutionary. But it did challenge the legitimacy of the colonial enterprise, saying essentially that the main purpose of colonial rule was to prepare colonial peoples for independence. That is to say, the main purpose of colonial rule was to make itself unnecessary. It also included, the mandate system did, however partially, colonial populations in a system whose purpose was to make government more accountable to them, which Wilson, this accountability, Wilson viewed as key to world peace after the war. So far we focused on what Wilson wanted and why, but of course we should also emphasize that his wartime rhetoric resonated well beyond its intended audiences, and that rhetoric was given meanings that went well beyond his own plans and intentions. Wilson may have wanted reform as a bulwark against revolution, but for many who heard him, his words and the opportunities they appeared to create had revolutionary rather than reformist implications. In fact, by the war's end, the president became world famous as a symbol of the coming world order, onto which various groups, as we've already heard a number of times for a number of speakers, various groups both within and outside Europe projected their fondest hopes and dreams. His words helped inspire and mobilize anti-colonial movements in regions from North Africa to East Asia, including in Egypt, in India, in China, and Korea. And those of you who want to read a whole book about that, it's in the bookstore. And Wilson's failure to make good on his perceived promises of self-determination led some anti-colonial activists, including the young Ho Chi Minh, the young Mao Zedong, and the young Jawaharlal Nehru, to look to Bolshevism for inspiration and support after 1919. And it's no accident that the Chinese Communist Party is founded in 1921. Still, after 1919, self-determination became a central principle of international legitimacy, where it persisted. Franklin Roosevelt, who had served in the Wilson administration as Assistant Secretary of the Navy during the war and during the peace negotiations, has actually spent at least a few days in Paris as part of the U.S. delegation. Franklin Roosevelt recommitted the United States to that principle of self-determination during World War II when he compelled the reluctant Winston Churchill to include it explicitly in the Atlantic Charter. Churchill then had to go back to London and explain to everyone why that didn't apply to India and to other British possessions. FDR also took it further, this principle, than Wilson had, particularly as it applied to territories outside Europe. And this is an issue or a research that I'm working on right now, so I can talk about it at length, those of you who are interested. Indeed, the support for the emergence of self-determining nations and their incorporation into institutions of international governance were the two main elements of the international order that the United States did go on to establish at the end of World War II. Can I say World War II here at the World War I Museum? I don't know if it's... get away with it. Of course, what FDR did not sufficiently account for, we now know, is the tension at the center of U.S. advocacy for self-determination. The tension is, of course, this. What if a nation, having gained its self-determination, determines to take a path that is not aligned with U.S. interests? In other words, what do you choose when the principle of self-determination clashes with other principles or interests that you hold dear? Already by the late 1940s, Washington chose what it saw as the containment of communism over support for colonial self-determination, most prominently when it chose to back the French war against the Viet Minh, led by Ho Chi Minh, in Indochina. And then, when the French lost the war, the United States took it over itself. And Vietnam is just one example. Throughout the post-war decades, the post-World War II decades, the principle of support for self-determination remained prominent in U.S. rhetoric and self-image, even while its policy often flouted it in practice in the name of containment or other pressing concerns and interests. So where does that leave us? First, I hope that I've convinced you that in order to understand what Wilson came to Europe to try to do, we must first take account of the intellectual capital that he applied to the problem, capital he built up over the two decades of thinking and writing on U.S. history and politics. And that his analysis of the conditions of modernity in which Americans found themselves by the time he was elected president was centered on the desire to escape the dialectic that he saw as playing out between the concentration of unaccountable power on the one hand and the dangers of revolution on the other. And that once he came to the presidency, he applied this framework to world problems, first in Mexico and China, then in Europe and in the world at large. Now, if I have convinced you of all this, I have to say that the legacy of all this is also complicated. In one sense, and I know I'm going against the grain of historical consensus here, Wilson succeeded. The League of Nations was in fact founded, and several new independent states arose from the wreckage of fallen empires pursuant to the principle of self-determination. In another sense, however, he clearly failed. He could not convince the Senate to ratify the treaty. The U.S. remained outside the League, and the League itself was but a shadow of what he imagined it might be. And self-determination, too, proved even more complicated than he suspected, not only in its attainment, but also in its use. Still, in a limited but important sense, Wilsonism, as they called it at the time, became the blueprint for the construction of a U.S.-led liberal international order, an order that, as it solidified after 1945, has undergirded international relations and defined international relations for the better part of a century. Whether it still is there to define our future, I'm not so sure. We'll have to wait and see. So thinking about this history, then, highlights the tensions and contradictions that were embedded in such a project as Wilson had undertaken from the outset. It also reminds us It also reminds us that it is an order, the liberal international order, that is now facing unprecedented challenges, both at home and abroad, and that it is doing so also under circumstances that are eerily reminiscent of those of a century ago. If we look at our present, it is easy to see ourselves, perhaps even too easy to see ourselves, as undergoing a new Gilded Age, with accelerating globalization, large-scale immigration, rapid economic and technological change generating social dislocations and political crises, a steep rise in inequality that is challenging long-standing social contracts and political institutions, both in the US and abroad, and the recrudescence of concentrated, unaccountable power. We live today, then, in a world not unlike the one that Wilson saw around him in the early 20th century. A world in which we are, speaking globally, not cousins, still less brothers, and yet continue to search for a way to build, quote, a community of ideals and of interests. Thank you.
Gentlemen, we would open the floor to your questions. And the first question will come from the gentleman on the left.
Yes, that was fascinating. If I could pick up on your theme of failures, Wilsonian failures, mm-hmm. I'm thinking that it didn't have so much to do with his intellectual capital, but had to do more with his character. Mm-hmm. That he was, at least as far as I can tell, a very stubborn man, a self-righteous man, and that this was a major factor why he wasn't able to persuade others mm-hmm. of the value of his thinking and of his intellectual capital and his ideas.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that's a great question. I think, for me, it's not an either-or proposition. I think it's both and. His intellectual capital, the tensions that I outlined, and of course his character had a lot to do with it as well. I will add, and this is important to remember, that Wilson actually, both as governor of New Jersey and as president for most of his two terms, was actually quite an effective politician and quite a compelling politician. He was able to convince a lot of people of quite a few things, not least with his rhetoric during the war. He was able to convince innumerable people around the world that he was the man to make the change that they wanted to see in their own affairs and in world affairs. He, at the same time, his failure at the end of his political career is undoubted, and it has to do with his character. It also has to do, and there's research on this which is really interesting, with the deterioration of his health. As I'm sure you know, in early October of 1919, shortly after he came back, he had a major stroke, which essentially put him out of commission. It's very likely that he had minor strokes in the months prior to that that didn't you know, invert his character, but made him perhaps more stubborn and less flexible than he might otherwise have been. And you know, counterfactual history is hard to do, so it's impossible to know for sure what would have happened had he not had those strokes. But I think it's not difficult to imagine that he would have been able to reach a compromise look, Henry Cabot Lodge was a Harvard man. Wilson was a Princeton man. So I don't know, that might have been doomed to fail to begin with. But but let's, putting that aside for a second, the Versailles Treaty with the League of Nations Covenant did garner a majority in the Senate. It just didn't garner the two-thirds majority constitutionally required for ratification. So I think it's not implausible to think that a healthier Wilson would have been able to convince the Senate to go through with it, and maybe then we have a different assessment of his legacy.
Erez, thanks. Great talk. I'm really intrigued by how you're framing Wilsonianism and intellectual origins and this idea of anarchy. And I can't help but think about Woodrow Wilson's very extensive writings about the Reconstruction era. I wonder if you could maybe talk a little bit more about that and make the connection between how he's writing about conceptualizing Reconstruction as this anarchic period of anarchy, just make it simple, and how he's then applying that to his ideas of self-determination, particularly as it relates to colonized peoples in Asia, Africa, and elsewhere.
Yeah, no, I think that's a great question. And, you know, I'm not qualified for psychoanalysis, so I can't say for sure whether Wilson's experience in the U.S. Civil War was one of the elements at the basis of his fear of anarchy, but I wouldn't be surprised if it was. A boy who grows up in antebellum Virginia and then South Carolina, and suddenly the whole world falls apart in front of his eyes, and that could very well be at least part of the explanation for his fear of anarchy and anarchism, and for his attachment, therefore, to this idea of reform, to this idea of gradual and nonviolent change, as I like to call it a strategy of containment. The idea is to contain revolution, to contain disorder, and to do it, and his, as a historian, he knew that history always involved change, and so you can't do it by keeping things static, and the only solution that he could think of is reform and nonviolent change. And so what you see, and specifically to your question, in response, when he realizes the echoes that his rhetoric has in parts of the colonial world, his response is mixed. On the one hand, he has no particular support for or love for this sort of European territorial imperialism. On the other hand, he has an even greater fear of anarchy and disorder. And for example, let's just take the example of the Egyptian uprising in 1919 against British rule in Egypt. At first, the United States sort of the State Department puts out mildly supportive statements, or appears to put up mildly supportive statements. And then the British go to Colonel House, actually, and they say to him, look, it's your president's fault that the Egyptians are rising up, because they think he's bringing self-determination, and it's creating chaos. And when reports come from Egypt that some of the protesters are being violent, they're knocking down telegraph lines, sort of the infrastructure of imperialism as they saw it, Wilson hears that, and of course he never cares all that much about the self-determination of non-white peoples, because in any case his instinct is that, even without knowing anything about Egypt, his instinct is that they're probably not prepared for it, maybe they need more time. He actually builds, there's a history there with Wilson's policy on the Philippines, right, where he has this approach of, you know, gradual move toward self-government. And so when the British convince him with regard to Egypt that his words have helped to cause violence and disorder there, he quickly backtracks, and they issue a statement where the State Department issue a statement where they say, well, we're sympathetic toward Egyptian desires for more self-government, but we are completely opposed to violence, we're completely opposed to disorder, and that's not the right way to go about things. And in some ways, the mandate system, I think, encapsulates precisely those tensions that you were alluding to. Yes, there is an end goal of independence for these colonial peoples, but it has to go through all of these different stages and needs to be reformist and nonviolent.
We have time for two more questions. The first will come from this side, and will be closed out by Dr. Tammy Proctor.
Speaking of the mandates, there was some talk about possible U.S. mandates in the Middle East. How serious did those discussions get, and is there much documentation of what Wilson's general reaction to those proposals were?
Yeah. The best of my recollection, the biggest part of the conversation about a possible U.S. mandate in the Middle East was over Armenia. And as we've already heard actually from the Yitz presentation yesterday, the Armenian genocide was very well publicized in the United States during the war. Henry Morgenthau, who was the U.S. minister, right, to Istanbul, who reported back on all of this during the war, who was an associate of Wilson. And I think my sense of it is that Wilson was sympathetic toward this idea, but it was not a high priority for him. And once he got the sense that the Senate and the U.S. public was not going to be supportive of a kind of ongoing, it would have required some kind of ongoing military presence in that ongoing conflict in Asia Minor. And I think his sense was that the United States just couldn't do it, and it petered out. The other element that had to do with the mandates is, of course, the famous King Crane Commission, or at least famous in some circles, which the United States sends to the Levant, you know, the parts of the Middle East that today comprise Lebanon, Syria, Jordan, Palestine, Israel, and they meet with literally hundreds of delegations there this American commission and get their views about what should be done. And basically their view is we want an American mandate. Well, we want independence. If we can't have independence, we want an American mandate. If we can't have an American mandate, maybe we could live with a British mandate, definitely not a French mandate. That was kind of the order of preference, but independence would be the best thing. And what happens with the King Crane Commission, by the time they write this great report, which you can find online, by the time they come back and deliver it, the United States has just left Middle East, and this Margaret McMillan was referring to this yesterday, it left the Middle East to the British and French, and it's just their report is just buried by the State Department, never published, and never acted upon.
Thanks for that. That was really great. I'm just thinking that you could almost float a picture up in the middle of Hoover, too, who, you know, is politically opposite in so many ways from Wilson, but they're working together during the war. But he's making the same argument about why feed Europe. No return to monarchy. Avoid social revolution. And so my question is, well, first, did Wilson just convince him of this while they're working together? Or is there a broader kind of sense that this is the U.S. role in the world? Yeah. Or is Wilson shaping it?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. And one of the things that it reminds me that I need to emphasize is that I'm making no claim here that Wilson was an original political thinker and that those ideas that I described were original to him, that he came up with them by himself and that no one else was saying this. This is not the case at all. He was reflecting a fairly broad sensibility among Americans, among American progressives, as we would call them at the time. What makes Wilson stand out is, of course, he had a great deal more power than any of these other individuals, particularly at that moment in 1919, when he comes to Paris, and as we see in the mural upstairs, he's at the center of everything. And you know, the Germans want an armistice, so they go to Wilson, right? They don't go to the British and the French and so forth. So it's his power that distinguishes him rather than his ideas. He's the one best placed to put these ideas into implementation. Now, what Hoover does is it's kind of the difference between humanitarian aid and political change. So Hoover is worried about revolution, and he says, well, we'll feed these people, and we'll stem the tide of revolution temporarily. But Wilson is thinking, I'm not saying that Wilson is a better thinker than Hoover, but he's just positioned differently, right? Hoover has his own job. Wilson has a different place in the firmament, and what he's thinking of is kind of long-term political requirements in his view, stem the revolutionary tide, restore order through reform, through more accountability. But it doesn't surprise me at all that they were there was overlap in their thinking. I mean, I don't know if you would call Hoover a progressive, but there are certainly some shared aspects in that thinking.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking Dr. Erez Manela.